In physics, we have this nomenclature. We have unified field theory, which actually started with early attempts by Albert Einstein to unify general relativity, which described his theory describing the force of gravity, and electromagnetism. There were only two forces of nature known at the time. Then eventually physicists found that there are two other forces, the weak and strong, the nuclear forces, subatomic forces. And we have now the standard model, which describes three out of four known forces of nature, electromagnetic, weak, and strong, with spectacular experimental success. But of course, a lot of questions remain. For example, it has a Lagrangian of standard model, has something like 19 parameters. A lot of people are not satisfied with it. They feel that there are much deeper theories yet to be discovered, right? And so then grand unified theory in physics refers to an attempt to merge these forces into a single unified force, including gravity. So for now, we don't have a quantum field theory of gravity. String theory promised us to give one, but they failed in doing so during the period of 40 years. And it looks like it doesn't look very good. If you had to bet, I think that you shouldn't put your money on this. It's investment advice. Don't put any money on this. Maybe short it. You know, like in the markets, you can buy stock, like on a short. So shorting it probably still a good idea, but I think the stock has come down quite a lot because more and more people are kind of wake up from this dream and kind of like, look. At the reality of the situation and say, look, you know, we have to move on to other things. All right. And
now,
so
just a moment. Do you say that with any reservation because you've published in string theory in the past or you've published with one of the most famous string theorists?
So speaking of Forrest Gump, right? So not only did I publish with Langlands and all these other people that I've mentioned, I also published a paper with Ed Witten. Okay, and in 2007, around the time when this book that I mentioned was published. But see, this is the thing. With Witten, we published a paper about mathematical ideas involved in string theory. And actually, it was not even string theory, but more like quantum field theory in higher dimensions, you see. Well, higher dimensions is not a proper term. You see, string theory kind of turns things upside down because in string theory, the field theory which is involved is a two-dimensional field theory because you're considering propagation of strings, right? And what is a string? It's like a circle. And when it moves, it sweeps an area. So it sweeps something two-dimensional. So in effect, you're studying embeddings of what we'll discuss later called these objects called Riemann surfaces. Think of the surface of a donut or of a Danish pastry or a sphere. Okay, they're maps or embeddings into the space-time. So the space-time is on the receiving end of these maps, but the theory itself is defined on the surface, you see, on the Riemann surface. That's weird because you're taking the two-dimensional field theory in which the target space is the space-time. Normally we take, the theory is defined on the space-time. So the roles kind of switch, which is kind of like, it's really cool if you think about it. But string theory is not just a theory of a quantum field theory on a Riemann surface, because in string theory, once you study these models, the quantum field theory is defined on surfaces. That's not enough. That's the first step. The second step is to integrate over all possible Riemann surfaces. And that involves summation over all possible topological types, like sphere or a surface of a donut, and so on. The parameter, topological parameter, is called a genus. So sphere is of genus 0. A torus is of genus 1. The Danish pastry with two holes is of genus 2. The pretzel is of genus 3. So I have to sum up the results corresponding to each topological type of a Riemann surface. And then for each of them, you have to sum up over all possible complex structures, basically. In fact, you have to sum up over all the metrics, but because the theory is what's called conformally invariant, you actually end up with a finite dimensional integral over what's called the moduli space of complex structures on the Riemann surface. So string theory is not just a two-dimensional quantum field theory defined on a specific Riemann surface. So if you imagine some two-dimensional world, you know, like some bugs, for example, let's say you have like a globe in your apartment or in your house, and you have a little spider who lives on that globe. So that spider's space, well, it's more space than space-time, but okay, let's forgive me for this difference. Let's assume that the space-time of the spider is a sphere. is the surface of the globe. So then the quantum theory that this spider would observe, if it were indeed his or her space-time, would be a two-dimensional theory defined on a specific Riemann surface, namely the surface of this globe. You see what I mean?
Yes.
But that's not string theory yet. String theory is when you consider spiders living on all possible Riemann surfaces. And you sum up every calculation, you sum up over what happens for across all of them. So that's string theory. So that's a very simple explanation of the difference between quantum field theory and string theory. So first of all, quantum field theory is not defined on a space-time. Rather, space-time is on the receiving end of maps from a two-dimensional surface to this space-time. So the theory effectively is two-dimensional. Then the theory is what's called conformal invariant, which gives us a possibility to actually sum up over all possible choices over Riemann surface. And it's when you sum up, you get amplitudes from string theory, you see. So that's the, and you have to admit that it's a very cool idea. It's a very cool idea. You turn things upside down, kind of. That your space-time becomes the target space of the theory. It's not the space, the ground of the theory. It's a kind of additional ingredient of the theory. The theory itself is defined on Riemann surfaces, but it's sort of like, it's a cool idea, but at the same time, it's actually kind of like precipitates its own demise, string theory, because then the question is, which space-time do you have to choose, you see? So it does not lock you, because you don't define your theory on your space-time that is given to you, which is this our universe, which has three spatial and one time dimension, but it becomes a parameter,
right,
of your theory. And so, but the point is that it's an essential condition is that the theory be conformally invariant on the Riemann surfaces, which means that all the metrics, that if you rescale your metrics locally, then you will get the same result. And this enables you to go from an integration over some infinite dimensional spaces, which is basically intractable, to actually finite dimensional spaces. Instead of integrating of all metrics, what's called metrics on the Riemann surface, you go to the integral over all complex structures, which is a finite dimensional manifold, so that the integral in principle could be computed, even though there are all kinds of singularities that need to be regularized, which no one, as far as I know, has been able to do in general, actually. But at least there is a path to doing it. But the problem is that your space-time is a kind of an external thing that you put into the theory. And the question is, how do you differentiate between them? How do you say, oh, the space-time has to be this? And so one condition is that the theory has to be conformally invariant, and that means that it's Calabi-Yau. So you probably heard this said many times, that the target space of string theory is a Calabi-Yau manifold. Calabi-Yau manifold is one for which the corresponding two-dimensional theory of maps from your Riemann surface, say a donut, surface of a donut, a sphere, and so on, to your space-time is conformally invariant. But the problem is that there are too many Calabi-Yaus, and the problem is the string theory is only when defined when this manifold is 10-dimensional.
Right.
Superstring theory, to be precise. Superstring theory. String theory, it would have to be 26-dimensional. So it's a much bigger gap from what we observe to what string theory allows you to work with. So the first string revolution in the 1980s was the going from bosonic string theory to supersymmetric string theory, where you have a sort of a balance between bosons and fermions, which enable to bring the dimension down to 10. And 10 is kind of is much closer to 4 than 26. So you have 6 extra dimensions. And then physicists say, oh, okay, well, these 6 dimensions, they curl onto this little Calabi-Yau manifold. But which one? And the problem is nobody has been able to find. And the problem is also that it's not just a single one, but it's moving also with the dynamics of the theory. This Calabi-Yau manifold, this extra 6 dimensions, is also changing. And nobody was able to, and those changes lead to some long-range forces which nobody has been able to observe. So therefore, it's like immediately in contradiction with experiment. Not to mention that it's supersymmetric. So you have to, and we don't observe supersymmetry in this universe. So anyway, that was a long kind of aside digression on string theory. Just to show you what the problem is, if you're a physicist, this is a major issue because your job, you only have one job if you're a physicist.
Yes.
Well, I mean, quantum physicists. Obviously, there are other areas of physics like solid state physics, statistical physics, and so on, where models are much more diverse. But if you are a quantum physicist who works you know, on finding the theory of everything or grand unified theory.
If you're a high energy physicist in fundamental physics.
The high energy physicist, you only have one job, which is to describe this damn universe. That's your job. You're not interested in describing all possible universes, 10 dimensional and so on. But mathematicians are interested in all of them. So that's the difference between us. That's a major difference. As a mathematician, I love 10-dimensional manifolds. Or 10-dimensional spaces, if you
will. Yes, exactly.
They're just as good. They're my children, just like 4-dimensional space-times. I don't differentiate between them. I love all of them, you see. So, or even infinite-dimensional spaces. So for briefly, it's mathematician is interested in a space of any dimension. A high-energy physicist is only interested in 4-dimensional spaces. And not just some generic spaces, but the ones which are realized in this universe. Now, there may be some other universes which are 10-dimensional. And maybe this theory describes those universes. Okay, first of all, you know, how do you find out if it's true or not? You have, like, pick up a phone and they talk to some aliens who are even 10-dimensional and say, congratulations, you have found the grand unified theory of our universe. Congratulations. But what yes. good is it for us? Now, I have to also add, there is also another aspect that by doing this more general theories, you can actually stumble upon some ideas, which you may find it more difficult to, you know, understand in the realistic theory. And then you can try to adapt it, to tweak it, to apply to this universe. So for instance, lower dimensional theories are usually simpler than higher dimensional theories. So for instance, two-dimensional theories have been a great playground for physicists to try to develop ideas, or some three-dimensional theories as well. There's a famous work by Alexander Polyakov, a brilliant, you know, Russian-Soviet physicist about three-dimensional instantons and three-dimensional gauge theories, which became classic because it gives you a mechanism of how instantons contribute to correlation functions, which we still don't understand how to apply in four dimensions. And if we could, we would be able to solve the problem. Confinement problem, trying to understand why quarks cannot be separated as you move them apart, which is a feature of four-dimensional gauge theory. This is just one example. There's this phenomenon called instantons, which is understood much better in three dimensions and in two dimensions than it is in four dimensions. But this is that province, that area of research where you try different models in other dimensions. It's called mathematical physics proper, really. That's the overlap. If you think of a Venn diagram, I said Zen diagram. Well, yeah. Venn diagram, okay?
Something else.
Zen diagram is something else, probably. So if you look at the Venn diagram of mathematics and physics, yes, there is this overlap. And that's called mathematical physics. So all my life, I was very interested in that because, you know, as a kid, I was very interested in high energy physics and quarks and so on. And then I learned that actually you have to understand mathematics to even speak about those theories. And as I delve deeper and deeper into math, I realized that I actually love mathematics proper. But also occasionally...
It was SU3 that got you inspired.
SU3, that's right. The quarks, the description of elementary particles in terms of quarks, which goes back to Murray Gell-Mann and this Russian mathematician Zweig as well. So anyway... So my work with Witten was kind of in mathematical physics because it was about understanding certain models which are closely related to quantum field theory and potentially string theory as well. But it doesn't, for example, those models are supersymmetric.
The geometric Langlands conjecture that Witten worked on, it is in four dimensions though.
Yes, in a sense, yes. Yes, true. But supersymmetric theories, that's what I'm trying to say.
People think, the general public thinks of supersymmetry as just one supersymmetry, but there are extensions. There are perversions of supersymmetry.
So
there are
called,
n equals 2, n equals 3.
That's right.
You have extensions.
And, so typically we study n equal 1, n equal 2, and n equal 4. And that's called maximal supersymmetry. So what supersymmetry, by the way, is a very simple idea. It's just that you have one of the requirements of quantum field theory is the invariance under the Poincaré group. Right, the Poincaré group combines the Lorentz group, which is a kind of all rotations or pseudo rotations in a Minkowski space, right, and translations. So Poincaré group is built as a semi-direct product of the Lorentz group and group and the group of translations. In supersymmetric everything in your theory has to be invariant under this action. So, for instance, the space of fields, the space of states has to be what's called a representation of this group, of the Poincaré group. In a supersymmetric theory, this representation has to be extended to a bigger group, but in fact, not a group, it's called supergroup. Because it has both bosonic degrees of freedom and fermionic degrees of freedom. The bosonic degrees of freedom will stay the same. It will be the same Poincaré group, but there will be some fermionic transformations. They're kind of weird little transformations. They're kind of like little shifts. They are not even bona fide transformations in the ordinary way. And so this way you get an enlarged supergroup, which depending on its size is classified as n equal 1, n equal 2, n equal 3, n equal 4. But the biggest one you can get, given all the requirements of quantum field theory, is n equal 4. And that's the theory we're talking about. That's the theory which exhibits what's called electromagnetic duality, gauge theory, super Young-Mills or super gauge theory, n equal 4, in four dimensions, exhibits something that's closely connected to the geometric Langlands correspondence, which is called electromagnetic duality.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.